Hi, my name is Christina Zhao, and I'm a research assistant professor at the University of Washington. I'm an auditory neuroscientist. That means someone who studies how brain interact with all the sounds in the world. I'm especially interested in how babies use their brains to learn and absorb information. So I spend a lot of time trying to figure out how babies' brain respond to different sounds, like speech or music. And I study speech and music because there are two most important ways that people communicate. What I love the best about my research is that it is very interdisciplinary. That means I get to work with experts in many different subjects, like physics, engineering, and more. So there's never a dull moment. From as far back as I can remember, I've been super, super interested in sound. I speak two languages, Mandarin and English, and I played piano for many, many years. I think all of these experiences made me more interested in studying how brains interact with sound. Up until college, I had no clue that you can make a career out of research in this subject, spending all day studying these fun questions. But then in college, I got to be a research assistant for my psychology professor, who was an expert in how newborn babies react to speech. That really opened my eyes to a whole research field. I use many different tools to do research, and the coolest of which is probably the magnetoencephalography, or MEG for short. It is a machine that uses very sensitive sensors to look at a person's brain activity from the outside without hurting them. We can put a baby in the MEG and play different sounds for them and look at how their brains react to these sounds. By doing this, we learn that how baby brains respond to different speech sounds can help us predict how well and how fast the baby learns language. We also learned that giving babies a lot of active musical experience can affect their brain responses to speech. So now we're trying to figure out whether there are brain patterns that can let us know if a baby might have trouble learning to speak, and we're also trying to learn if music can help those babies. So now I'm going to answer a few questions by kids at the PAC Science Summer Camp. Parker asked, can you see the sounds in the brain? What a fun idea. Yes, in some parts of the brain, sound information can be seen in patterns of how neurons fire. And we can play these patterns on a computer like a sound file. And you can even kind of hear what the sound was. Clara asked, do different kids make different patterns on magnetoencephalography? Absolutely. Every brain is different. While we tend to find that some things are similar across many people, each brain makes unique patterns, and sometimes we can learn a lot by the way that everyone's brains are a bit different from each other. Here's a question from Francis, Matthew, and James. How smart are babies? Are they smarter than you would think? Babies are really smart, and probably a lot smarter than you think. They know a lot more about the world than we thought, and they also learn super fast. To give an example, a newborn baby can already tell their mother's language from other languages, and they can also tell their mother's voice apart from a stranger's voices. All these learnings took place before the baby was even born. Here's a question from Ida and Parker. Can you see animal brains on the MEG? How do animals respond to people talking? Awesome question. As far as I know, researchers have already put few different types of monkeys in the MEG and compared how their brain responses to human brain responses. These questions are super important for us to understand the evolution of the brain. But I don't know about any research looking at how animals respond to people talking using MEG. Maybe that's something you will figure out in the future. Charlie and Olive wants to know, what is your favorite part of your job? My favorite part of my job is coming up with new experiments that will allow us to study the big questions we want to know more about. This usually involves coming up with some new ways of doing things, and sometimes even new tools. To take a quick example from our previous question, say we want to study how animals respond to people talking, then we need to figure out a lot of specifics. What animals do we want to study? Monkeys? Birds? Dogs? Or cats? And why? What languages are we going to use? English? Spanish? Chinese? And again, why? What kind of brain responses do you think we'll see? and why. The process of predicting what your outcome would be is called hypothesizing. And finally, what if the results are very different from what you hypothesized? What should you do next then? Eva asked, have you ever gotten stuck in your studies? If so, how did you get out? Yes, getting stuck in research is very normal, and things actually don't turn out as you hypothesized very often. But these are great learning opportunities for us because we get to think hard about what might have gone wrong. And often the results teach us completely new things. Maybe what you hypothesized was not correct. Then you get to design new experiments to follow these new questions until you figure out what is really going on. Matthew asked, would you want someone to learn about your brain? I volunteer my brain to different research studies all the time, and it is super fun. I love the idea of helping research in this way. I don't necessarily learn about my own brain by volunteering, but I think it is cool to get to help other scientists to answer their cool questions. Sometimes you do get a nice souvenir from being a participant, like a picture of your own brain. There's one last question. What is a challenge you faced in becoming a scientist? What advice would you have for young scientists today? The challenge that I faced to be in this field was that I did not realize how important math was going to be. You might wonder, why do I need math when I study brains and babies and sound? But in fact, math is everywhere. We use math to understand sound and show how the brain responds. We use a special type of math called statistics to help us figure out whether our hypothesis was right. I was very thankful for my early years of math training because it helped me catch up a lot in graduate school so that I can do my research. So it is important not to count math out too soon. You will probably need it a lot no matter what you do in the future. Feel free to get in touch with our lab to learn what studies we're currently working on. We're always looking for participants of any age, particularly kids and babies. Thank you for watching today, and we hope to see you in the lab sometime.